Good afternoon. He's an artist. I heard it say several times when people talk about their favorite piano player or when they see this one image in the museum that they're all raving about. It seems that artists are no longer people, but they're like sort of aliens. They can do something more than we mere mortals. Solitary geniuses and full of passion and thriving on mystery and on a strange force of nature that we don't know. And I agree. I think that art at its best gets people moving and gets people wondering and gets people changing their mind. And you can surpass your ordinary life. But an artist, in my opinion, is certainly not required to be this weirdo in the attic, making some beautiful poetry, hairs in the wind, just saying, I feel so inspired. Not at all. I think this is a very romantic image, and it has already been replaced several times. There is a new paradigm actually emerging. And it has been around since the turn of the century, and it is actually radically changing the way we think about art. I will take you to a brief stroll in art history to end up with what I think is happening. Let's take the Flemish master Rubens as an example. He was productive for 43 years. And so take a wild guess how many masterpieces left his workshop each year. 10, 20, 50. Actually, in the 43 years, 25,000 images, paintings has left his workshop. For me, this is amazing. Rubens was not an artist. This was a factory. He had 80 people working for him. And this was a whole organization. The word that comes to mind when I go to the Rubens house in Antwerpen is hustler. He's an entrepreneur. He has his act together. You have to think about stupid things like a sales process. How is that guy, was he able to do sales in a time where there was no phone, was no internet, everything had to be done by postal carriage? It's amazing. The pigeon was actually the fastest way of communication in that day and age. And how about the production process? There were no machines whatsoever. And you have to know, this is really, really strange. Rubens could only paint hands and eyes. The rest was done by the workshop. He had a specific guy doing small animals, another guy doing grass and green stuff, other ones doing the images of the holy people. So he had a real segmentation in his working force. How about delivery? There was no FedEx. You had to do the same postal card. Rubens had his own security company to protect the images when they went to Spain, to St. Petersburg, and so on. Think about that. Not an artist, he's a hustler. We move on. Here, the artist with a capital A comes closer and closer. Goethe wrote, Delighting des Jungen Wertes. And this is actually what God's people do now, dress up to go to parties. In the 18th century, you dressed up like Werther. It was a real craze, even people dying about that. It was the first actually hype in art history that came along. And gave Goethe actually the status that he has now as an international artist. But Goethe was so much more. Goethe was somebody who insisted on having translations ready from day one so that the rollout in Europe was instant. Then he started traveling to Paris, to London, to Berlin, talking about his work in saloons, actually people convincing people to read his work. So here again, this is not your typical artist, hairs in the wind. This is an entrepreneur. Now we're there. The cultural aristocrat, James Joyce, Picasso, Stravinsky. Here we are, true artists. There are gods in the religion of art. But something strange was also happening at the end of the 19th century, and certainly after World War I, World War II, art became institutionalized. We founded art schools, we founded museums, opera houses, ballet companies, and so on and so on. The so-called cultural boom. And with them, arts councils, funding bodies, magazines, royalties, copyrights, bureaucracy. And then, like every ordinary lawyer or doctor, you went to art school, you got a degree, and then you went for a position, teaching at a art school or being in a symphony orchestra and so on. Take Rachmaninoff as an example. We all think, yeah, this is the godly piano player, Rachmaninoff, and he certainly was really, really good at piano playing. But what he was certainly better at was securing lucrative record deals. He had this one, his master voice. You all know the dog barking to the gramophone player. Rachmaninoff was the first artist ever to be licensed his image to his master voice and so on. So really, he was more of like a good salesperson than a piano player. But artists in general were working now. We were working people. And some artists already did enter the market. Other ones still needed that cushion of museums and so on between them and society. But still something strange was happening. Somebody else was paid to think about the numbers, to think about income and so on. And there were, of course, overlaps. But in general, artists were working people and part of a professional society. So we are now arrived at the professional artist. Every artist that I know now has a VAT number. We are our own boss, and we think this is the new normal. Is this actually a good thing? I truly think it is. The institutions that we formed in the 40s, 50s, and 60s are now disintegrating. The middlemen are cut out. As an artist, you no longer need to be part of a famous school or a famous orchestra to be successful. You just go to Kickstarter. You fund your project over there, you go to GoDaddy, have your own website, you have an interesting Twitter account, and you're good to go. In the old paradigm, you had to put in 10,000 hours to be that fantastic horn player or that amazing painter, and you stayed with that. Once a painter, forever a painter. In the new paradigm, it's more important to have 10,000 contacts on Facebook. That's where you're now at. It's happening. Artists are diversifying their business, artists are becoming global players in a world that's more and more flat. And we see actually in art what is happening in society in general. We change from depth to width. But now we're in the age of the customer. And as you know, every marketing book will tell you this, the customer is always right. We see a democratization of taste coinciding with democratization of creativity. Or to put it in buzzwords, consumerism is followed by producerism. I'll give you a short example. This is what you needed until the end of the 90s to make a good record or a good sounding album. This is what you need now. Everybody can make music, everybody can make movies, and so on and so on. And as long as you're well networked, you're good to go. Being even the fact that everybody's a creator right now, or could be one, even I can take a decent selfie from time to time. Works of art become commodities, and art goes back to being a craft, and artists become artisans again. So we're back at Rubens, artisans again. And I like that, because yeah, everybody now has the same tools, but still there are huge differences between what I made as a movie on my iMac or what Steven Spielberg does. Craftsmanship is still the denominator. And art, as an art with capital A, will disappear. But that's nothing to worry about, I think. Artisans, they can be entrepreneurial, and they can now reach out to an ever flatter global community. We live in the best of art times, and we live in the worst of art times. And I'm looking forward to whatever you are creating now as a consumer and a producer. Thank you.